The words that I remember the most from my very happy childhood were, "Let's take the scenic route." As a child, I was excited, wondering what we would find around the bend. As a teenager, I would groan. Mom was driving, we would invariably get lost. The journey would take an hour or more, and we would end up eating an unpalatable lunch at some unknown British pub. Today, I yearn to hear those words again. Let's take the scenic route. By taking the scenic route, my mama showed me hidden beaches, old trees with the light just filtering through them, and quaint little towns that we would never have seen otherwise. My mama saw adventure in every day. He used to say, "If you've done one new thing today, then today was worth it." Every day, when I would walk in to see him, from the time that I was 7 or 8 years old, he would ask me, "What new thing did you do today?" If I had nothing, he would be disappointed. In a world where everything is black, white and grey, and maybe with a layer of dust over it in this city, Mama would see it always in 4D Technicolor. He saw life as seconds filled with endless opportunity, not days of going through the motions. He used to tell me, Lewis Carroll had once said, he would quote all the time, "Actually, the best gift you could have given her was a lifetime of adventure." For Pranav and me, he certainly gave us that. He got a thrill out of everyday things, trying a new type of cheese, renting a new car, wheeling all the children of the household around on his wheelchair for wheelchair rides, driving just over the speed limit, making a reckless investment with a small amount of money, checking into a too expensive hotel and then getting a buy one, get one free deal at the same hotel. All these things gave him so much pleasure. It didn't matter that he was in a wheelchair. It didn't matter that he endured pain every single day for the last too many years. Every single day that he lay down in the office in between just so that he could get through his day. Even that he had cancer. He is the only person I know who managed to struggle with his demons and come out on top each and every time. He is the only person I know with strength so immense that he drove home with clots in his lungs, with a blood pressure of 80 over 40, and was still committing to drive to Malvern the next day for a business meeting. From the time that I was a 6-year-old sleeping in his bed, to the last few days when I was still lying in his bed, there was only one answer to the question, "How are you feeling, Mom?" "Bilkul fit." "Perfect." Even during the last month, his concern was only for those around him. "Rajinder, Vanita ke liye max mein room arrange kar do. Kitni der ICU ke bahar bench pe soegi?" "Setu, hamesha paise kharch karke yahan aa jaati hai. Tere sare paise kharch ho jayenge." "Kushal, time jao. Ghar jao. Time dekha tumne? Bacche wait kar rahe." He passed at midnight. And even as late as 9 PM, he was asking Anju aunty to close issues at work. Work. He loved his work. Emil was his life, his mission, his purpose. Emil wasn't about making money to him. It was about people. Mamu had the ability to take ordinary people like you and me, and turn them into something extraordinary. He believed that every single person deserved multiple chances, not just one second chance. And he gave them freely. He always gave everybody the benefit of the doubt. I can say without doubt that there isn't a person on this planet who disliked him. He was also by far the best negotiator I've ever met. Just a few months ago, just after chemo, by the way, I saw him negotiate a business deal that left me silent. I was taking notes. I kept trying to figure out where the catch was. I can't share details, but let me tell you, the other side got completely thugged. mention my uncle without mentioning his relationship with my nanny. His relationship with his mother was indescribable. She was his guiding light, his soulmate, the person who taught him, who taunted him, who loved him, who cared for him, who did everything. I remember this one time when we were sitting at the kitchen table in London. This was about 5 years ago, and Nani wanted to go shopping and Mama wanted to go work. Typical situation. As always, she made an unreasonable request. He refused, saying he had work. She abused him in colourful terms and then threw a capsicum at her almost 60-year-old son. Of course, he did take her shopping in the evening. He and she would also relate the story of one time when he was throwing up all over the place. And the reason he was throwing up was because she insisted that he eat something that he didn't want to eat. It was most probably non-vegetarian, but I forget what it was exactly. So apparently he sort of brought it back up. She pushed it into a spoon and ran after him saying, "You have to eat this. You can't just, you know, chuck it up because you don't like it." He used to love entertaining, and their home was always filled with guests. So many times I would complain to my mom, "I don't get any time with him. There's always someone there. What's the point?" I shared this one time when he got some overseas customers from work, and he'd been entertaining them. My grandmother had done dinners, business dinners, every day for about a week and a half. He told Nani on the way back from work that he needed dinner for 12 people, again, with about 20 minutes notice. My grandmother, who was usually quite patient with his request, greeted him at the door with a note. "I hereby tender my resignation as your housekeeper. Please order in today." They fought, they laughed, they played endless games of Scrabble, they traveled the world, they did new things, but always together. I'm glad that they're together again now. No tribute to him is complete without mentioning his relationship with Narayan. Narayan bhaiya, aap aaoge? Narayan bhaiya? नारायण भैया उनके दूसरे बेटे थे। एक समय था जब उनका भरोसा थोड़ा हिल गया था, फिर भी उन्होंने नारायण भैया को अपनाया जब सारी दुनिया उनके खिलाफ थी। नारायण भैया उनके दोस्त थे। तैयार होने के समय कमरे का दरवाजा बंद होता था, और एक दो बार मुझे अचानक से कुछ लगा कि क्या हो रहा है यहाँ पे। अंदर से जोर जोर से हंसने की आवाजें आती थी जब वो नहा रहे होते थे। अस्पताल में हर डॉक्टर नारायण भैया से ही पूछते थे, "हाँ बेटा नारायण, तुम बताओ, तुमको सूजन कैसे लग रही है? कम लग रही है?" उनके लास्ट शब्द थे, "नारायण बेटा, चल 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 चल." Those were literally his last words that he said. They showed his love for Narayan and his need to keep going. Today I can only stand here and salute the love and care that Narayan bhaiya gave. He was also the most unselfish human being that I have ever known. March 22nd, my daughter Nina's birthday. Mama was still in hospital. He wasn't able to speak clearly as his tongue was swollen because of an allergic reaction. And he wasn't able to lift his hands very much because he was recovering from a procedure. Communicating with difficulty, he got my mom to source mermaid blankets from some obscure place in Delhi, which was 2 hours away. My daughters are obsessed with mermaids. He got a musical card, he wrote in it with shaking hands, and he got us to decorate his hospital room with pink balloons so that she could cut her cake there with him. Everything was only about making her day special for her, and this was March 22nd, 2018. My ma, his Vani, and he shared a bond that is rare. From the time that he broke his spine and she was practically the only one there, at the age of 11, they have been inseparable. He coached her at table tennis, making her Delhi state champion. He introduced her to the man she eventually married, his best friend. He coached her through life, for the last 9 months as well. He provided Sunday relief when she needed to get away from a slightly claustrophobic environment. I know she will most miss their 5:30 a.m. conversations. My dad, his best friend, the one who sat stoically through his chemos, who built him a new home so they could all be together. They were chalk and cheese. You could not imagine more diametrically opposite human beings. Yet their love for each other was so great that they made it work. Ultimately, he was the only person whom he trusted to tell him the truth about his health. For me, he was my hero. Even during the last days, he continued to inspire me. I read out here something that I wrote on March 12th while waiting for a diagnosis in a doctor's waiting room. When heroes fall, the sky flashes with lightning. The earth splits in two. What do you do? What do you do when you see resignation on the faces of the undefeatable? Pain on the faces of the men of steel. The trucks they lifted, were they made of foam? Was the red cape just a sheet? Is kryptonite just an everyday disease? The sky clears a little. And you see. You see their everyday heroics. You see them pick up their phones even when they can't type. You see them be polite to strangers in waiting rooms even when they're in unendurable pain. You see them get through each day a second at a time when each day stretches to infinity. And you realize that your heroes still live. For what defines them is not their broken bodies or their tired spirits, but their ability to put one foot in front of the other and survive and inspire. The earth heals. The sun peeps out from behind the clouds and your world is whole again. At times like this, of great sorrow, I have to remind myself that sorrow exists only where there has been great love. Mamu, I will always hold you in my heart. You will always walk with me and guide me like you always have. I love you today, tomorrow, forever.